horror films. That's what I call them anyway. Strange movies with vague, poetic images I don't always understand. Long, dreamy movies about distant technicolor pasts. Even longer black and white movies about the general meaninglessness of life. I don't really get why she likes them anyways.
When Aaron and I go to the movies, we drive our cars separately and meet by the box office. Inside the theater, she sits tentatively in her seat, ready to move if she can't see well, poised to leave if the film is disappointing. She leans away from me, careful not to touch the bare flesh of her arm against the bare flesh of mine. Sometimes, she leans so far, I'm afraid she may be touching the woman on her other side instead. If the movie is very good, she leans forward too, peering between the heads of the couple in front of us. The light from the screen bounces off her eyes. She gleams with intensity, sitting there on the edge of her seat, watching the screen. Once I tapped her on the arm so I could whisper a comment in her ear. She jumped.
That movie was so terrible. I can't believe how bad it was.
You know, I think I kind of liked it, actually.
I was going to ask if I can come over after this date, but I know I don't sleep well in strange beds. It's just that after movies like that, I feel the need to assert myself.
Alright, well, I guess we'll just see you later.
Alright, bye.
Bobby takes me only to movies that she thinks have a redeeming social conscience. She doesn't call them films. They tend to be about poverty, war, injustice, political corruption, struggling unions in the 1930s, and the military-industrial complex. Bobby doesn't like propaganda movies, though, and she doesn't like to be too depressed either. We stayed away from the sorrow and the pity. It would be, she said, too much. Besides, she assured me, things are never that hopeless. So most of the movies we see are made in Hollywood, because they are always very topical. These movies offer what Bobby calls food for thought. When we saw Coming Home, Bobby's jaw set so firmly with the first half that I knew we would end up at Poppin' Fresh Pies afterwards.
That's fated to pretend. Why is life made only for to end? Oh.
Sam likes movies that are entertaining. By that, she means movies that Will Jones of a Minneapolis Tribune loved, and either Time or Newsweek rather liked. Also, movies that don't have sappy love stories, are not musicals, do not have subtitles, and will not force her to think. She does not go to movies to think. She liked California Suite and The Seduction of Joe Tyan, though the plots, she said, could have been zippier. She saw it all coming too far in advance, and that took the fun out. She doesn't like to know what is going to happen. I just want my brain to be tickled, she says. It is very hard for me to pick out movies for Sam. When Sam takes me to the movies, she pays for everything. She thinks it's the right thing to do. But I buy my own popcorn because she doesn't approve of it. The grease might smear her flannel slacks. Inside the theater, Sam makes herself comfortable. She takes off her jacket, puts one arm around me, and all during the movie, she plays with my hand, stroking my palm, beating a small tattoo on my wrist. Although she watches the movie intently, her body operates on instinct. Once, I inclined my head and kissed her lightly just behind her ear. She beat a faster tattoo on my wrist, quick and musical, but she didn't look away from the screen. Things were going really well with Sam and I. Then the other day, she told me about her girlfriend back in Duluth. I go to some movies by myself. On rainy Sunday afternoons, I often sneak into a revival house or a college auditorium for old Technicolor musicals. Kiss Me, Kate, Seven Brides for Seven Brothers, Calamity Jane, even once, The Sound of Music. Wearing saggy jeans so I can prop my feet on the seat in front, I sit toward the rear where no one will see me. I eat large handfuls of popcorn with double butter. Once the movie starts, I feel completely at home. Howard Keel and I are old friends. I grinned back at him on the screen, admiring all of his teeth. I know the soundtracks by heart. Sometimes when I get really carried away, I hum along with Catherine Grayson, remembering how I once thought I would fill out a formal like that. Skirts whirl, feet tap, acrobatic young men perform impossible feats. And then the camera dissolves into a dream sequence I know I can comfortably follow. It is not, thank God, Bergman. If I can't find an old musical, I settle for Hepburn and Tracy, vintage Grant or Gable, on Adventurous Days, Claudette, Colbert, or James Stewart. Before I buy my ticket, I make sure it will all end happily. If necessary, I ask the girl at the box office. I've never seen Stella Dallas or Intermezzo.
The characters smile at each other. I smile at them. I feel they are smiling at me. In the movies I go to by myself, the men and women always like each other, and that makes me happy.